Here we go, I hope. Yeah, here we go, we're off and running. Okay, there's this wonderful dilemma right now that I'm seeing. Is that, you know, the what's going on in the world is such a compelling movie, isn't it? That, you know, it's very difficult not to watch what's going on. And what I feel like is if I don't comment about any that, I'll lose the audience. The audience can say, wow, this is just too compelling. If I just ignore it, you know, that everything will just evaporate. So should I just ignore it, or should I, you know, make some comment about it, or what? This is a big dilemma. The Holy Spirit keeps telling me over and over, last 3 or 4 days, it's amazing the consistency the Holy Spirit addresses. They just say, this is I am now. This is I am now. And that's the answer. This is I am now. Now, if I just say, this is I am now, I said, well, nobody's going to listen to this. They got, you know, that it's not that they don't want to. It's that the stuff that's going on in the world is just too juicy for, you know, for words. And the thing is that, you know, everything that's going on in the world is debatable, right? If you look at every side of everything, you say, well, you know, that's debatable. The new religion of the world is environmentalism, of course. And, you know, but is that, you know, is it true or is it debatable? Is there some debate? Some will say, no, it's true, but it is debatable, right? Everything is debatable. Who's the right candidate? That's debatable. What's going to happen? That's debatable, you know. You look at every issue and it's debatable, but there's one thing that's not debatable, that is I am. This is I am now. When you experience the non-dual, which is there is nothing to get free of, then you just realize this is I am now. I am now. Okay, I am now. This is something that is fundamental, the Holy Spirit said, this is fundamental to our identity, that I am is now. I am now. So every time I keep asking for an answer to some question, the Holy Spirit just somehow shows me some amazing miracle. It just says, keep staying with this is I am now. Now apparently, the Holy Spirit wants to offer the world something more compelling than what's going on in the world. We see, so perhaps, you know, this is I am now, somehow that can become very compelling to people. Now, today I saw the danger of trying to mainstream spiritual teaching. But it's debatable, is this intentional that we're trying to mainstream spiritual teaching or not? That's debatable. So almost everything is debatable. I mean, I can look at it two different ways. Really, I could. I took this side and I said this side. Well, how do you solve this? It's debatable. Certainly, trying to mainstream something like A Course in Miracles can be a very dangerous thing for the mind, because it basically says, you know, everything you're perceiving, thinking, it's all nonsense. You know, you don't know what you're talking about. You don't know. You're seeing only the past. You know, and it makes you lose your confidence in common sense, and just you start questioning yourself. Wait a minute, you know, and it can easily fall into a situation where you're desperate for confidence, and then a demagogue can come along and seize, and you'll follow them, you know, which is what's happened in the world. Actually, what's happened right now is due to the liberals in the 60s, 70s, 80s, those who call the open mind, those with open minds, dabbled in spirituality. Almost every liberal's dabbled in spirituality and New Age stuff, okay, wherever it comes from, a lot of different sources. And the result is they've been taught that their common sense isn't right, you know, that they don't really, can't really understand what's going on. And so they feel, wow, you know, I'm lost, I'm hopeless, what do I do? And it's very easy then for a demagogue to come along selling snake oil and acting like they're confident, like, and they think, oh, they're the one that knows. And they say, yeah, of course I know. I'm, you know, this is my destiny to help you out. And I know this is what's happened. Now, but the question is, was this all designed to help out the environmentalist movement? which is the new world religion, in order to save the world. So in other words, does the end justify the means? Is the question. This is debatable, isn't it? You can debate this for, you know, just nonstop. I mean, where do you end? You can't tell, can you? You don't really know. I don't really know. Are the extraterrestrials really saving the world? Saving the ecosystem? Is that really what's going on? Are they taking it over for their own selfish, evil purposes? You can debate that, absolutely. I mean, the power structure goes ETs through the contactees, which are part, corporate, global corporations, and part radical feminists, actually. And the combination of that then goes through political figures, and then that goes through, you know, the environmentalist movement. Is a whole kind of thing that the ETs are doing. Now, are they here to save the world, or are they here to take it over for their own malevolent purposes? See, very debatable, very debatable. And how do you determine that, you know? I can't determine for sure. No matter what conclusion you come to, it is debatable. It is debatable. So what the Holy Spirit keeps telling me is, go to what's not debatable. Just say, this is, I am now. This is, I am now. When you're in that non-dual state, you can just say, this is, I am now. That's not debatable, because you're aware that this is, I am now. There's no debate about it whatsoever. Now, you can debate, well, is this right? Is what we should be doing or not? Okay, that's a different story, isn't it? But to identify where you are is not debatable. When you say, this is I am now, you will know that this is I am now. Okay, I am is now. This is I am is now. This is I am is now. I am is now. And we will experience that this is not debatable. Okay, this is what the Holy Spirit tells us we must do. And I've been praying to Jesus, the Holy Spirit, and they keep giving me the exact same answer. Just practice, this is I am now. That's it. So I'm trying. I'm not, you know, I'm sputtering along. Full disclosure, I had an emergency today. I had to go. I had to drive 6 hours almost straight today. I was feeling very tired and stressed out. And midway through, I had to drink some Coca-Cola and a mocha frappuccino from a Starbucks mocha frappuccino in a bottle from, you know, convenience store. It's a caffeine to stay awake. I couldn't have driven. I couldn't have made it. There's no way. I was, after 3 hours, I couldn't stay awake. It was terrible. A very dangerous situation. So I had to go on the caffeine as an emergency here. I feel fine now, but the caffeine does interfere with the subtle sensitivities, etc. So I can talk just fine. As far as practicing, it does interfere with practicing, I would say. No question about it. We've pointed this out many times. So that's just a disclosure. So we're mostly talking about flipping the script here and bringing this up, that my mind keeps being led back to, this is I am now. This is I am now. This is apparently the most powerful statement we can make. It's like the end of all practice, virtually, you know. This is I am now. Apparently, this is what enables us to awake. Okay, by saying, this is I am now, where all we do is identify where we are or what we are, you know, just our condition. This is I am now. The mental state that we'll be in when we awake is that this is I am now, and just identify it. Don't, you know, that's all you do. And then, you're on solid ground. There's no debate about it. There's no debate. And you don't get pulled into debate. And in that, this is I am nowness, you become aware okay, let's put it that way. You're aware of I am nowness is what you're aware of. That's what you're aware of. So you say, this is I am now, meaning I am aware. My awareness is, this is I am now. This is I am nowness. And you just abide in that. You just abide in it. So while other people are debating all this other stuff, you say, well, you know, I can't help people with that, but I can help them with, if they want to abide in I am nowness, I can help with that. And I am nowness, there isn't any problem. There are no problems. Everything is seen as perfect. It's all perfect. It's beyond what we can imagine as perfect. It's we cannot intellectually grasp it. So you just have to state it. Don't use your intellect to try and grasp it. Instead, just state where you are. This is I am nowness. This is I am now. This is I am nowness. This is I am now. Now, very peculiar, right? It seems very peculiar. And so I keep thinking, no, Holy Spirit, it must be, I got to figure out, you know, who's right and this and this and that. Holy Spirit keeps saying, keep trying, keep doing, this is I am now. Keep doing this. This is very important. This is like the knockout blow. This is I am now. And we need the knockout blow right now. Because the script of the world is getting incredibly compelling, isn't it? I mean, even I'm getting pulled into it. Which, you know, I have to admit, I'm not immune. And I think we all have to be honest with ourselves and say, you know, I'm not immune to it. I don't know many, if anyone here is immune to it, unless they're dwelling on this is I am now. I think that's the only immunity there is to it, actually. This is what I believe, that there's only one immunity to what's going on in the world, and that is to say, this is I am now. This is I am now. And abide in this is I am now. This is the only immunity there is, and this is what the Holy Spirit is trying to tell me. There isn't any other immunity. And I keep looking to see if I can settle the debate. You know, who's the right leader? Who's the right candidate? You know, what are the conspiracy? What's conspiracies going on? I mean, the stock market had a glitch today. You know, it's like, is there some test of a cyber? Was it a test of, you know, a cyber attack? Was it a hacking test to see to test out the vulnerability? You see, you know, the Chinese stock market is crashing. You know, is this a cyber attack on them? You know, what is going, you know, all this stuff. It's like, wow, you know, and it's just every day, as the Holy Spirit warned me, it's getting exponential. It's just this super compelling drama that's playing out. And the Holy Spirit says the only immunity from this is to say, this is I am now. And of course, people say, well, I need help. And what the Holy Spirit is telling me is that the only help there is to say, this is I am now. That's the only help. And so this is really tough to accept, but I accept it. You know, I have to accept it. It feels true. This is what we've been warned about, that in the end times, you know, there'd only be one way. Even the elect are in danger of, you know, getting pulled into the drama, right? And so I'm saying, yeah, I'm in danger of getting pulled into the drama. There's no question about it. I mean, it's just outrageously compelling, you know, as far as drama goes. Holy cow. You know, what is really going on behind the scenes? I mean, it's just like, you could not make a movie that even touches this, what's going on. So, the only safety is to abide in, you know, this is I am nowness. This is I am nowness. Abide in that. That's it. So you're certainly not going to help anyone if you don't do that. If you make them think what they can sort things out, well, you know, who's good and who's bad and who's ultimately, you know, how things gonna work out and which way to go here and there. See, just say, this is I am nowness. There's no question about which direction you're going or how you got somewhere or going anywhere or anything. You say, this is I am nowness. That's it. That confers immunity. This is refuge. This is refuge. This is refuge. And this is what the Holy Spirit has been guiding us towards, which is refuge. Take refuge. So I'd like to thank those who have given feedback on this. It's very helpful. You know, the intuitive feedback on this. This is I am now. This is I am now. This is I am now. The Holy Spirit says this is the key. This is absolutely vital. And just in time. I mean, this came right at the time where we had to have this. The drama will just bewitch us, is what's going on now. It's very bewitching. The Greek thing, the Puerto Rican thing, you know, I mean, it's got everything. The Marxism, the capitalism, you know, the atheism, the war against religion, you know, this on and on and on and on and on. It's just, you know, this massive, compelling drama that causes us to, our mind goes into this debate state of mind, like debating this, debating that, debating this, debating. And that doesn't bring stability. There's no stability in debate. Okay, keep in mind that there's no stability in debate. There's no stability in debate whatsoever. Show me any debate in history where there's been true stability in that debate. There isn't any. Nothing has ever been settled to the point of true stability in any debate. Okay? There's always dissenters here and there, etc. So, but saying this is I am now, I am now. This is I am now. There's no debate about that. It's an, you know, it's seen. It's just a statement of I am. I am now. So there's stability. This is I am now. There's actually, this is where you find true stability. Now, not saying that this is, you know, that there's no resistance to this. There most certainly is resistance. As we practice this, the mind is, you know, screaming, like, no, don't, you can't do that, you know. You got to watch what's going on in the world. You got to figure that out, you know, and debate. You got to debate that. You got to enter the debate. If you don't enter the debate, how are you going to be right? Well, how is stability ever truly attained by debate, real stability? The Holy Spirit says real stability is only in this is I am now. So I've got to try and roll back the looking at the news. I've been slipping into it gradually, insidiously, because I wanted to check to see if it was accurate that the 22nd of June would be when all hell started to break loose. And it was very accurate. And it all hell is breaking loose. There's no question about it. People are absolutely inflamed. And a new player arrives on the stage every day. Just, you know, and that will not stop. It will get more and more and more and more and more. And this is the great danger of going down this road, is once you get too enmeshed in it, you know, how do you pull out of it? You start following so many different storylines, and they become so compelling that your whole life is wrapped up into it, and you can't stop. So, you know, the only way to take sanctuary is this is I am now. This is I am now. I don't know, you know, how compelling that state of mind will be for anyone. I mean, that truth, you know, will be for anyone in this world. I don't know. I really don't know. There's no way for me to determine that at all. So, you know, but I guess all you can say is for yourself, it will certainly provide stability. Will it help others? I don't know. But you can hardly help others unless you first help yourself. If you haven't accepted stability, how can you encourage others toward true stability? You know, you wouldn't be doing it. You'd be encouraging them towards debate. And there's no way to get more help to people by also engaging in debate. It doesn't work that way. You can't have it both ways. So, you know, it's just I am. This is I am now. It seems very puny, right? You think, well, I gotta augment that. But the Holy Spirit says, no, there's nothing more you can do than that. That's it. That's the sum total of everything you can do. This is I am now. So I really do have to just put an end to listening to the news. Just, you know, take a moratorium on it. Take a week off. Take a week off and just say, no, I'm just going to focus on the Holy Spirit. It's been so consistent saying, just keep practicing. This is I am now. This is I am now. Now, when you say that, you're not trying to figure something else out, you see. If there's something distracting, you say, well, fine. But this is I am now. Where I'm abiding, this is I am now. So if there's something else really compelling, you don't have to debate it, whether it's compelling or not. You just stay where you are. Well, yeah, okay. Is that compelling or not? Well, I'm not going to debate it. I'm just going to say, this is I am now. Now, I found myself this morning getting very enraged, like a zealot, and I was ready to start to launch a one-person campaign, you know, but I realized it would only be a one-person campaign because I'm so courageous that I'd be able to do something and nobody else will follow me at all. It's true. Nobody would have my back. Nobody. They wouldn't do it. So a one-person campaign, I realized that this folly, what good is that going to do? It's not going to do any good. It's not going to do me any good. It's like charging into the ranks of the enemy and everybody else turns and runs away. And it's just, what good is that? That doesn't help anyone. You know, I mean, there are ways to, you know, fight back in this world against what we see as oppression, but people are simply, there's no way that they can just reverse things and see things completely differently on social issues. It just doesn't work that way. It does not. You can't do it that way. You know, I just saw the complete impracticality of it. That it's ideally, you know, it's just an ideal. But there's no practical way to get to that ideal. And the Holy Spirit certainly doesn't support it. This is what I see. It does not. It only supports I am, this is now. I am, this is I am now. This is, it only supports this is I am now. I keep asking you, so what are you supporting, Holy Spirit? Only this is I am now. That's it. It seems to be only what Jesus is supporting too. Jesus doesn't seem to say anything about social events or one way or the other. The former president Jimmy Carter said, you know, Jesus, I believe Jesus would support gay marriage. He said, people weighing in on that. Well, Jesus has never said anything to me one way or other about any social issue. Never said anything about any world issue at all. All Jesus is saying is to say, this is I am now. That's it. I don't even think Jesus has a position on anything that's happening here. On the environment, on this world, nothing. Nope, never gotten a hint of any position on anything. So he must know best, right? And he must know that what's best for us to say, I am, this is I am now. This is I am now. So, you know, I can't give anybody any insight into how Jesus really looks at social issues, you know, one way or the other. I can only say that Jesus just says, look, just practice, this is I am now. Just practice it, just keep practicing it. This is I am now. And And so at some point, we just have to have faith in the Holy Spirit and in Jesus and just do it. You know, and yeah, it's not easy because we want to be trying to figure out, you know, what side of the fence do we need to be on? There's no fence in I am. This is I am now. There's no fence there anywhere. This is I am now. Now, whatever else is, you know, people say is happening, whatever, fine. But still, this is I am now. Where I am, this is I am now. Or we can say, this is where I am is now. This is where I am is now. This is where I am is now. And we'll just be stating a truism. You know, there's a truism. So we will experience it. We say, oh, this is where I am is now. Okay? There's no argument about that. There's no debate. You can debate whether you should be there or not, etc. But as far as where you are is not debatable. You say, this is where I am. This is where I am is now. Okay? And just state a truism. This is what the Holy Spirit is saying. Just state this truism. So I had a very frantic day today, very difficult. Emergency thing, very dangerous load I was carrying and long drive and everything was just very, I was very nervous and jittery. It seemed like it might be very problematical, but ultimately I was able to calm down enough, you know, to just keep saying, this is where I am as now. I kept going back to that, and somehow that saved me. I had a number at some place, and it was 13, and the man said, 13, wow, that's very lucky, unlucky. You have a very unlucky number. And I said, no, not today. 13's lucky number today for me. I just gave myself a special dispensation today. 13 is actually a very lucky number today. So I didn't buy into the negativity, like, oh, 13's an unlucky number. I said, no, I'm giving myself a special dispensation today. It's a lucky number for me today. And he laughed at that. He didn't expect that kind of response, you know. So somehow, you know, it seemed like the universe was trying to sink me today. There's no question about it. Very slippery, dangerous day. And I was saved by the Holy Spirit. He kept giving me indications in one way or the other that keep saying, this is where I am is now. Like I'd see a license plate that would say, like, said, this is now, you know, or something. Really? I mean, I saw a license plate that said, I believe, this is now. you know, just asking for help, and then, yeah, I see a license plate like that. And just all these little things I just notice, like the Holy Spirit gets my attention, you know, and it pulls me back to, this is where I am is now. This is I am now. This is I am now. This is I am now. It seems like I've been talking a long time here. This means I'm really tired, actually. Yeah. Because I seem worn out. went over the Golden Gate Bridge today. Of course, in San Francisco. And coming back, going from north to south, there was some... Two of the lanes were closed. And there's all these emergency vehicles there. I said, uh-oh, car crash? No, it was not a car crash. So they were dealing with somebody on the bridge, a pedestrian. Now, you know, what was such a huge emergency out there? Some big emergency out there. Well, I don't know. Could have been a jumper. You know, could have been somebody got up on the, you know, on the railing or something. There's a lot of jumpers off the bridge, actually. They could make it pretty much jump-proof, you know, but they don't. They don't, because the tourism, you know, the tourists like to look down at the water. You know, I hate walking across that bridge. Just hate it. It's terrible. Because you can't help but, you know, grab the railing and look down, and then you just realize, oh my gosh, how easy it is to just jump off that bridge. It's ridiculous. And you just, oh, don't like it. I saw something too. It just said, today, it says lights might snap. And I was looking at the snap, and I realized we're at the snapping point. I snapped this morning, actually. I was on the edge of snapping this morning, absolutely. Because the weight of the madness of and the diabolical, seeming diabolicalness of this world, you know, the debatableness of everything has just become so outrageously intense. I just felt like we need a resolution. I mean, we have to do something to fight back like that. So it's a time that people are snapping. So I'm driving across Golden Gate Bridge, and it seems as though someone may have snapped on the bridge. So thank God for the Holy Spirit, thank God for Jesus, thank God for the advice we're getting. Which is say, this is where I am is now. This is where I am is now. Just being factually identifying where I am is. This is where I am is now. I am is now. So we say, when we're our awareness, we would say, oh, I'm aware that I am is now. I'm aware that I am is now. This is where I am is now. Aha. This is where I am is now. Okay, so we're not debating. We don't have to get, this prevents a debate, you know, and this enables them to get used to it. This is why it's so important. Because theoretically we could debate and say, well, okay, you know, this is, theoretically we could debate it, but instead of debating, we say, well, you know, don't debate, just state the fact, well, this is where I am is now. And the ego will say, well, you know, I am is not always now, or you don't always want to be there. Well, that's a different story. I'm not going entering into those debates. I'm just, I want to just state the fact, well, where I am, I'm seeing, oh, this is where I am is now. So this is where I am is now. This is where I am is now. Stay stable with just stating this fact. Identify where you are, where the I am is. This is where I am is now. Now, this is not an easy practice. I can understand that. It's not easy for me, and I've been gone through a tremendous amount of practices, but I'm able to go with it. This is where I am as now, and it's all just a matter of just staying with that. That's it. Don't get fancy. And there's this intense pressure to try and get fancy and enter into some debate. Don't do it. See, just resist that. Just say, this is where I am is now. This is I am. I am now. This is I am now. Okay? No debate. So you don't sound so smart, right? You're not like beating someone at debate. You're not trying to beat anybody, defeat anybody or anything. You're just stating where you're at. Oh, this is I am now. This is I am now. Had a very nice impromptu dinner tonight. I was after the long drive. I just had some brown rice that had already been cooked and got that out of the refrigerator. What did I do? Cut up a lot of onions and red bell pepper. Put that on top. Poured a bunch of olive oil over it. Seasoning, hot sauce, salt, seasoning, hot sauce. And then covered it, poured a bunch of feta cheese, crumbled feta cheese all over it. Put it in the microwave for an hour, a minute and 30 minutes. Took it out, threw some tortilla chips on top of it and avocado. And then mixed it up. It was, and some, I actually put some beans, some refried beans, or not refried, but some, you know, yeah, I guess you'd say some Mexican beans, like it's, Heinz beans, that one went to the microwave too. And mixing it up, the brown rice, when you re-microwave brown rice, it tends to clump up into like pieces like meat, and it gets chewy. And so you like, it was hard to say what you're eating, but it was very, very good. Delicious. Very delicious. Sometimes the best meals are the one you just like throw together with whatever you got, you know, whatever you got, then it works out. Just the combination of the feta melted into the brown rice, clumping up with the olive oil and the seasoning and the avocado mixed in and the crunchy tortilla chips. And it's just like, wow. And I could have, we don't have sour cream, could have thrown some sour cream on it. That would have really been just an absolute knockout of a dish. Secret dish, you know, you can make that as a entree at some restaurant, because it's the clumping of the brown rice and the stickiness, how it clumps, that it gives a whole different experience to you know, you can't place it. It's really something. It's a little chef's secret right there. Cloudy day going through San Francisco. It was like I'd use a windshield wiper, so there was misting so bad. Windy, cold. So the people are debating everything. They lack wisdom. They lack wisdom. You know, the Holy Spirit has the wisdom, so we just have to trust in the Holy Spirit. What else can you do at this point in time? You know, I can guarantee you the Holy Spirit is saying, you know, do this. Say, this is where I am is now. This is I am now. This is the wisdom that we're. This is the advice we're getting from the Holy Spirit and from Jesus. I don't doubt that at all. It's been consistent now over day after day after day in so many different ways. It's been consistently saying this is wisdom. So we can hardly go the other way then. That would just be folly, actually. But, you know, our intellect cannot cannot itself determine this. But our reason tells us that the Holy Spirit is showing miraculous consistency with this. And so we have to give the benefit of the doubt to the Holy Spirit and not to our intellect at this point in time. The intellect just says, I don't know. I don't know. You know, it's debatable. It's debatable. But our reason tells us, hey, wait a minute. You know, there's overwhelming evidence that the Holy Spirit and Jesus are saying that this is it. So, you know, and then it comes down just to a choice, not a debate, but a choice, really. There's no debate about this is their position. And there's no debate about the intellect's position is it really wants to debate. You know, so reason has to come in and be the judge of which way to go. See, this is why reason's so important. The intellect is fired up right now, saying, wow, this is an opportunity to show how great a debater I am, you know, and jump into the fray. I mean, the intellect just wants to jump into the whole thing and just start being a hero, you know, and being, you know, bellicose about it. And the opportunities are just unlimited right now, absolutely, to protest one way or the other, to get involved in a free-for-all. You know, it's really like an invitation to a Western bar fight, you know, like a John Wayne movie, where the bar fight is just like the most awesome thing you've ever seen, where people are being knocked out the doors of the swinging doors of the bar, you know, sliding across the walkway, the porch walkway, the promenade, wooden promenade, and down the steps into what, you know, a puddle of mud, you know, and so the fight spills out into the street and there's mud everywhere. People are sliding down hillsides and covered in muck and mud. They come back in the bar, just chairs and tables are being broken, bottles are flying, you know, it's just like, it's like the best bar fight in history right now, actually, is a really great way to put it. And it's pretty tough. I mean, people are swinging from chandeliers, you know, and flying through the air and landing and definitely the best bar side I ever saw was some John Wayne Western. It was just like, what, it lasted like 30 minutes or something in the movie. It was like the whole movie was about a bar fight almost. And you know, it's just and so this is welcome to the world's greatest bar fight, is what you might say. The world's greatest bar fight started on June 22nd, 2015, and it's going to last about a year. Okay, that's the bar fight that's going on. And it's a very tempting movie, but I've sworn off movies, actually. You know, it's not where it's at. So it's a tough choice for everybody. You know, no, it is the choice we have to make right now, which way to go. You know, will we watch the bar fight? And the thing about the bar fight is, what's going to happen was first you start out watching it, but what happens is it's so compelling that before long you're actually participating in it. That's what will happen, no question about it. This is the danger, scary danger I saw. I saw myself getting very close to actually starting to participate in the bar fight, and I'd be a heck of a bar fighter. Yeah, there's no question about it. I mean, I didn't want to think about it because the ideas that were coming to my mind, it would just people. It would just be absolutely outrageous. You know, it would like intensify the bar fight to a tremendous extent. And the fact is, there are all sorts of people like this, who may choose to do that. We may find people jumping and popping out of the woodwork, just like Trump. I mean, there you go. That'd be like Trump times 10 popping out of the woodwork if I went that way. Just, people would just go absolutely out of their minds, what I would say. 10 times what they're, you know, what Trump is, you know, what they're doing with Trump. They just like go absolutely stark raving nuts. It would just be, bar fight times 10. And there may be, millions of people like that are going to pop out of the woodwork. They're just so inflammatory, absolutely inflammatory. And the whole, the bar fight just walls are falling down. I mean, buildings are collapsing. And the whole town is collapsing. The western, it's just the hillside is collapsing. It gets so muddy, the whole hillside, as they're fighting the bar, the whole hillside is sliding down into the ravine, they don't even notice, they're so intent on the bar fight. Everybody, and meanwhile, during the bar fight, they're all getting liquored up, to just to keep the pain, if keep from feeling the pain of getting hit so much, say hitting, getting hit hard, so hard, so many times, and people are, it's just the all-time greatest bar fight in history has already started, actually, and you got John Wayne basically in the middle of it, which is Donald Trump. I mean, Donald Trump is John Wayne, and the real John Wayne. Okay, John Wayne was just an actor. Trump is the real John Wayne, actually. He's actually in a real bar fight. This is not some Hollywood movie that John Wayne, they're cut, okay, let's do it slow motion, we'll speed up the film, cut, get all these, stuntmen and everything. No, this is Trump's in a real bar fight. He's the John Wayne of the bar fight. That's why everybody's finding it so compelling. They say, hey, wait a minute, this is like a movie here. Who is this guy? He's like, we kind of like this guy. He's like John Wayne. And so that's the trouble. I mean, John Wayne comes in and starts the bar fight. Hey, Pilgrim, what are you doing here? I thought I told you to leave town. And he says, you don't tell me to leave town, mister. Who do you think you are? I said, hey, and well, and before long, someone throws a fist, and someone shoves somebody, and then the bar fight's on. And so that's all that happened. Trump just, walked into the saloon and said, hey, I thought I told you I'm the new sheriff in town and we're going to do things differently here. And everybody says, all the people, the criminals in the bar, new sheriff, huh? Think you're a new sheriff, huh? Well, we run this town. Sheriff, and Wayne says, that's what you think, they say, yeah, that's what we think. And he says, well, we'll find out who runs this town, and then poof, the bar fight's on. And so we have this, just this bar fight's just warming up, and there'll be people coming in from all different sides. The whole town is running towards the saloon right now. Hollywood could never put anything as spectacular as this, we got a real life John Wayne, and it's hard not to follow, because it's just it's slapstick, it's over the top, greatest bar fight in history. But we're gonna have to walk away from it. This is the thing: walk up on the hill, get up on the hill. Why? Because the whole thing is gonna slide down, turn into mud, and collapse. And the people in the bar won't even know it. Imagine a bar on the top of a hill, and the hill is like all muddy, and the whole hill is just sliding down. It's a mudslide, and the people in the bar are still just fine. They don't know what's going on. The bar's tilting one way or the other, and they think just like they're punch drunk, and they've been hit so many times they're not really sure what's going on. And the bar's starting to collapse this way and tilt this way as the mudslide goes down. They just think, wow, I must be really drunk and getting hit too many times in the head. They don't realize it's a mudslide. And so the end of it is that everybody, the bar, whole bar, just like slides into this muddy lake, full of just complete pyroclastic flow of mud, off of like a volcano, and it's just muck, and they're just absolutely buried in this muck at the bottom of this pit ravine, and the bar is just completely splintered, and it gets covered in muck, and everybody's just buried in muck. That's what happens. That's the end result of it. And it's all distraction because everybody's so intensely into this bar fight, you know, they don't even know, they don't know what's going on. And before then it's too late. The muck just buries them. Whereas if you walk away from the bar fight, get up on a hill, another hill, say, wow, wait a minute, this doesn't look too stable. This whole mountain looks like it's unstable. Oh my gosh, I see it's starting to slip and slide. Holy cow, this is terrible. I got to get out of here. You're up on a safe mountain, a rock there, you know, where a rocky mountain where it's really stable. And say, ah, wow, you're not covered by muck at all. You're completely untouched by it. See, this is what's going on. This world is descending into the muck and the mire. There's no question about it. And the bar fight is just this massive distraction. These are actors on the stage, actresses, actors, that are trying to distract us. The whole thing is a setup so that we just get buried in the muck. The muck and the mire. So the bar fight seems fun for a while, you know, it's a nice distraction, but it doesn't end well. So I'll have to sit this bar fight out. You know, I have to sit it out. Now, maybe a lot of people won't. Maybe a lot of people won't do that. I don't know. But, you know, each one of us has to do what we see is the best, you know. And for me, I got to sit it out. Got to sit it out. But maybe I can help you, you know, help the world by warning you about what's going on. This is just a bar fight, okay? It's the ultimate bar fight. And, you know, it got kicked off with the principal character, you know. There's no greater character in the world right now than Donald Trump. You know, his life, his history, he's bigger than life. He is the real John Wayne. And, you know, it had to be kicked off this way. That's his role, to kick it off. And, of course, there's all these shady characters, you know, ready to pounce on him. And we've got this cast of shady characters that is just unbelievable. I mean, the POTUS is one of the most shadiest outlaw characters in history, actually. I mean, he's the perfect leader of the bad guys, you know. In the Westerns, you know, the leader of the bad guys often appears to be very sophisticated, real sharp suit, sharp dresser, really good manners, you know. But, you know, in the West, you know, that's the one who's really, you know, the smart, you know, leader of the bad guys, and all the bad guys around are very thuggish, you know. So you see the guys who are really thuggish, and then you see the real sharp, you know, criminal that's able to, you know, to organize them and call the shots and everything. They're often, you know, smoking a cigarette, a cigar or something, and, you know, playing cards and dressing real nice and affable. And sit down, you know, let's talk, you know, like that. And they're trying, they're very respectable, but we can see they're trying too hard to be respectable, right? They're trying a little too hard. They're trying to give the impression of super respectability. I mean, Westerns are awesome. You know, these kind of Westerns are just, you know, the stereotyping is brilliant. Because it reflects, I mean, that's modern day opera, you know, the Westerns. It reflects, you can, the stereotypes, which are true. I mean, you know, life does run true to stereotypes, there's no question about it. So, you know, here comes Trump in a saloon, and there's all these, you know, politicians, these shady characters. And here you see one over, the one, you know, the POTUS is the, you know, the slick, sophisticated, you know, I'm so respectable. You know, ringleader, and then the others are all corrupt. You know, they pretend to be on the side of good, you know, in the Western, but actually they're corrupt too. You know, you don't know who's the corrupt, but you know there's something shady about all these guys, you know, and Wayne comes in with a couple, Trump comes in with a couple of guys and say, yeah, we're kind of on his side and stuff, and the townspeople are running, say, no, sheriff, don't bother the bad guys, you know, we're scared, you know, sheriff, you know, they're running this town, you know, don't want to mess with them, you know, sheriff. Yeah, it's just, it's absolutely running true to like a movie, a Western. You know, and like the merchants come up to the sheriff and, "Sheriff, don't make trouble for us. You know what's going to happen. They're going to ruin our town. Just play along with them, sheriff. You don't know what you're getting into." And of course, the sheriff just wanders right in the saloon, says, "I'm not going to let anybody push me around. And nobody pushes me around. I'm going to clean this town up. I was sworn to do so. I got a star in my, I got a wearing the badge. Got to do it." And so this is what is happening. Here comes the sheriff. Sheriff has just come to town. And all those shady characters are now figuring out, how are we going to get rid of this sheriff? And the ringleader's not saying too much at this point. He's looking around like, "What are we going to do with this sheriff? Okay, we're going to figure out something here to get rid of him." Yeah. And the tough guys are coming up to him, trying to be tough. Yeah. Hey, what are you doing here, sheriff? Yeah. It's exactly. We don't like your kind around here, sheriff. We kind of like it the way it is. Sheriff, well, that's about to change. He says, "We don't want to change, sheriff. Maybe you better leave, sheriff. Maybe you gotta better take that badge off, you know. You're not wanted in these parts. Even look at the citizens here. They didn't want you here, sheriff. Why don't you just ride on out of town? That's what they're begging. The whole thing is just exactly like that. It's amazing how you could just make a western out of this entire thing. It is a western. It's a real western. It is a real Western, actually. But it's still just a movie, actually. It's all just a movie. It's a spiritual movie. So, you just have to say, "Yeah, it's a bar fight." People say, "Well, you're missing the bar fight. What are you doing missing the bar fight?" "Yeah, well, there's more than just a bar fight going on." You'd say, "There's more than just a bar fight going on. That's actually a distraction. What the real problem is, this whole hill is turning into mud, and it's gonna be a mudslide. And so I'm running away. I'm not running away from the bar fight. I'm running away from this mudslide. I'm getting to safety here." "Huh? What mudslide are you talking about?" "Oh, you see right here? Oh, yeah. It is. What do we do about it?" "Well, get the heck out of Dodge is what you do about it, friend." "Maybe I better get a cowboy hat." Whatever costuming just shows up, I'll just, hey. So we'll add a little twist of the Western here. This is the full Western that we got going right now. This is the full Western right now. Jesus rides into the town, or the apostles of Jesus ride into town and say, "Hey, I'm walking away. Where are you going? Where are you going, stranger? I haven't seen your type around here much, stranger." Say, "Well, I don't get around that much, but I just happen to be going through town right now. But where are you going? Everybody's down there at the saloon. There's a big bar fight down there. The sheriff's been attacked by it. It's really important. You might want to help the sheriff." I said, "Well, I'm gonna ride out of town, get to safety." I said, "Well, what are you talking about, safety there, stranger?" I said, "Well, this whole mountain is gonna collapse." "Mountain collapse? What are you talking about? It's been my place been here forever." I said, "Well, it ain't gonna be here much longer. You take a look at this. You see this mud here, and you see the mud here. You see this. You see how it's starting to move." He says, "Huh, stranger? Yes. I didn't see that before. Interesting. Well, I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do. Well, follow me. Going up this mountain here. We'll be okay there. You know how to get up there? Sure, it's not difficult." So, this is where we're at. If you've ever seen Westerns, you probably know exactly what I'm talking about, right? These characters, character actors like that, man, they had it nailed. So this is the greatest Western history. We can play our role. Our role is to head for the hills, actually. That is part of the Western, actually. We're not missing the greatest Western in history. We're actually part of it. That's part of it. It's just that we were never shown the complete script before, though. The Hollywood movies didn't have the complete script. Sort of truncated, you see. But now we're seeing the big script, actually. And the big script is the stranger comes into town and points out, the mud flow that's coming and says, let's get to higher ground where, that's not going to collapse on us. That's the full Western. Who sent you here, stranger? Where are you from? What parts are you from? What's your type of business you're in? Said, well, Jesus sent me here. Jesus? Who's Jesus? Said, well, someday you'll find out who Jesus is someday. But right now, let's get the heck out of Dodge here before the whole place collapses. Huh? That name sounds familiar. I might have heard that name before. Jesus, so I'm not really, can't quite remember where I heard that name before. Yeah, says, well, don't worry too much about it right now. Just get out of Dodge, while the getting's good. Then we'll talk about that more. You sure do have different ways, stranger. They said, well, sometimes, you gotta go against the flow. Right? Well, I've had some different education, and different parts unknown, Where are you from, stranger? From parts unknown. Yeah, we sure don't see your lack around here. Hey, we just hit the 102. How'd that happen? I don't know. That's amazing. I was just at a half an hour now, it's suddenly 103. Where did the time go? So, we cannot get caught up spectating in this Western. We need to play a role, and that role is to get out of Dodge. Head for the hills. These actors playing their roles well? Absolutely, they are. does the does Trump have, is he some knight in shining armor? No, just like in the Westerns, the heroes also got some flaws too, right? So you don't mind them getting a little bit beat up, you know, because, you know, they're a little bit overbearing and pompous and got all this swagger and they're not, you know, they're not perfect by any means, right? And Trump is far from perfect. So at least I abhor, you know, the beauty pageants that he puts on, you know, objectifying, you know, the female body as just these beauty objects, you know, is just abhorrent. And building these, you know, huge, glamorous, you know, apartment buildings around the world with all the glitz and the gold and the glamour. Yeah, this stuff is, you know, reprehensible in a lot of ways. You know, he's so much into image and glamour and glitz and all this kind of stuff, you know. So that's like his dark side, you know. That's the dark side. And he's got this other side, you know. He's willing to take on the bad guys, the real snake oil salesmen, the real sleazy criminals, you know, the politicians, you know, lowest form of life on earth, professional liars. And everybody hates them, really, you know, but they're so clever that we just can't stand up to him. But here comes this John Wayne figure that just, you know, doesn't care. So I'll stand up to all of them, you know. And so we're like, wow, you know. but it's far. See, this is the thing. He's far from. He's both sympathetic and non-sympathetic. You know, you like to see him, you know, knock around those politicians. At the same hand, you like to see him get knocked around too. You know, this is why it's so compelling. It's so compelling. You know, canceling the beauty pageants, great. Miss Universe, Miss Year, what a joke, yeah. What a terrible way to support the princess culture, you know. It's just horrible. And he's the principal guy putting those on. And of course, then some other channel picked it up, unfortunately. Because, you know, it's just, you know. So, you know, he's got that dark side to him. But it's not as dark as the politician. See, that's the thing. You can still be a like heroic figure because nobody is as sleazy as the politicians, you know. Especially the guy in the White House is the sleaziest of them all. The sleaziest of them of all time, without any question. He is like the absolute sleaziest politician in history. And nobody can seem to stop him, you know. He's just running rings around everybody, you know. He's so Machiavellian. And you know, so this is like, you know, but he's sending out all his thugs to go get Trump, you know, and Trump's just like knocking him around. They're knocking him around. And it's just like, you know, wow, the bottles are flying. The bartender's just like, you know, he's just like, whoa, let me dodge this and dodge that. He wanted drink here. The bartender's trying to keep some sense of normality, you know, still serving drinks here and ducking flying bottles. But at some point, the bartender, you know, gets down below the bar and tries to crawl out the door, you know, but he gets pulled into it too, right? You know, some place he says, I can't save this bar. I got to get out of here. Yeah. Bartender's really just fueling the fire of the whole thing. Here, have a drink. Here's another drink. Here's a bottle. Here, you want another bottle? Before too long, it's just mayhem. It's just mayhem. It's no more order. Just absolute mayhem. You got like, you know, how many candidates the Republican candidates? Like 15, could be 18 pretty soon, you know. I mean, it's just the saloon is absolutely packed. And of course, you got this lady, you know, pretends to be above the fray, you know. Of course, you always have this, you know. The madam of the place, you know, all dressed up. She just looks so sophisticated, so respectable. Of course, she's a complete congenital liar, you know, worst type possible. And that's Hillary Clinton. She's playing it perfect. I mean, who could play that role better than Hillary Clinton? Absolute congenital liar, you know. And yet, it looks so sophisticated and respectable. Oh, how respectable she is, you know. And she's like, above the fray. What are these? It's like, Boys will be boys. Look at this. Boys, come on now. You're ruining my saloon. The atmosphere. Don't tear the drapes, you know. Come on, guys. You know, it's like, wow. Boys. Like, you know, she's just so lily pure and innocent as this driven snow. And above it all, I mean, you couldn't cast a better character. And, of course, her husband, her husband, Bill Clinton, he's a real good fella. We've just been unfortunate. Me and my wife, Hillary, these folks just keep trying to characterize us like this. And, yeah, it's really unfortunate they keep trying to do that. But, no, we have never done nothing wrong in our lives. And we're really good folks, really. And so, you know, you got this guy, you know. And every now and then, of course, you know, they grab a bottle and smash somebody on the head with it, you know. But they don't want anyone to see that. And, no. We're the most respectable folks in town. What are we talking about? It's a shame. It's a shame this is going on. A bar fight going on. Terrible that something like this broke out. You know, it just isn't right for us respectable folks. And these people are caricatures, aren't they? Absolute caricatures. I mean, you couldn't have casted these people better. I mean, central casting done a heck of a job here, you know. They've done a heck of a job. I mean, these are actors from, you know, just the best. So, you know, it's hard not to watch it. We gotta stop watching. He said, you know, as much as we'd like to, you know, you're not that good. You know, you're good, but you're not that good. You know, let's be honest. It's the medium that's failing you. You know, we're not criticizing the actresses and actors here. And the casting, the producer, of course, which is arrogance, the ego. We're not criticizing the genius of it all, but it's the medium itself, you know, that is lacking. You know, that the fact that you're going to end up in the muck and the mire, you know, you have to factor that into the entire situation. You know, you can't leave that out of the picture. You know, you can't leave the ending out of a movie and say that it's a great movie, can you? How do you do that? You know, you can just isolate a scene, you know, and say, wow, this scene's really great. Well, wait a minute, you know, the movie keeps going and it comes to this end, you know. And so you have to look at the ending of the movie to really judge the whole thing properly, right? And so was all this expert distraction really, you know, so entertaining that being buried in the muck and the mire is something that you won't regret? And you say, oh, yeah, well, it was so fun for a little while there, you know. It doesn't end in such a fun way at all. So this has to be factored into it. So this is where I come into the scene, you know. This is my role in the scene. Like the actor that is just like, you know, who's this? Where's this going? Where'd you come from? Yeah, you know, it sure is odd. You know, this sure is strange. I don't know. You know, I don't understand. I can't quite place this. And yeah, this is what is it? How do they call that in the in theater? Is this it'll come to me. I'm sure the ancient Greeks in their theater and you know probably had something like that. Speaking of the Greeks, they're the ones who invented theater, right? Modern theater and all that. Well, you know, they're ready to put on a real strong drama very soon. Maybe as soon as Sunday. If they don't get their act together and they've shown no ability to do it so far, you know, they're going to go bankrupt. And the people of Greece are going to start rioting, probably, and fighting. I mean, it could get real nasty there. So they're adding their, you know, drama to the whole thing. You got this, you know, dark, you know, leader of Greece, you know, just this radical. He says he keeps thinking he's going to outfox the Germans, you know, and Merkel, you know. And so we got this drama. There's just dramas all over the place. But for Americans, the bar fight is truly where it's at. We like a good Western. We understand that here. And most of the world likes a good Western too, don't they? I mean, it's the most popular genre of movies, I think, worldwide there is. You know, even the martial arts movies all took on off on a Western theme, you know? That it just works. It just works. It's some archetypal sort of situation, you know, and it's very amazing. So know your role, you know, as they say, know your role. So I gotta do my role. We gotta do our roles. Be like a Rolls Royce, you know. It's like during this bar fight, you know, there's just going on, and somebody like rolls into town with just like total money bags. I mean, just it's like wealth beyond comprehension to the citizens, and just like, what? What's this? Someone truly sophisticated, you know, and truly wealthy. Says, you know, and they say, well, guys, you know, I'm just stopping here to get some gasoline, that's all. And I'll be headed on up to, where you going, mister? I'm just going up to campground up there on the hill, you know. You want to come along? Well, I don't know. How far is it, mister? Hey, it's not far. You know, come along for the ride. Well, I don't know if I can sit in your nice Rolls Royce there, you guys. Says, well, yeah, it's okay. I'll put some seat covers on. It's got seat covers on. Don't worry. Really, I got muddy boots. I said, well, we got floor cover covers. Some mats covering the floor, too. It's okay. Hop in. We'll take a drive. Well, I better go ask my family, you know. And tell the family. And the family says, you can't leave our house. What are you talking about? We can't leave our house in here. Well, I just want to go up and look at the camp up there. Just gonna take a look, see, and I'll come on back. And, you know, people, they take a look, see, and they say, hey, they come back, hey, there's a real nice place up there. Look, it's very stable. This place here, you know, looks like it's getting kind of unstable. I think the Greek drama had some often had a someone playing the role of like sort of like the mystical divine, something representing truth, you know, mystic ultimate truth would enter into the drama somehow as in some role. Maybe a beggar comes through, or you know, they'd write that in there, and then people just say, hey, you don't quite fit in with what's going on here. You know, this is kind of gotten surreal now. What's going on? So the whole thing then starts becoming surreal. But it's not really surreal. It's just that the people are not seeing the bigger picture of the hillside rate is starting to, you know, flow down towards the ravine, starting to slip. And the, you know, seeing the ravine, let me realize, you know, how it ends up is in the muck and the mire, buried in a pyroclastic flow, so to speak. And so it's not really surreal. It's wow, you know, wow. We better find just stability. This is not stable here. someone like come like riding in the town on this like white horse. There's a totally peaceful horse, and all the people look, who's that horse? That white horse. Never seen a horse like that before. Nice horse, real nice horse. Look at that horse. They come up to the horse, looking at it. You know, says, wow, that's such a quiet horse, such a calm horse, such a peaceful horse, such a healthy horse. Never seen a horse like that. Where'd you get that horse, mister? I said, well, I'll tell you someday, you know. As a matter of fact, come on up to the camp and I'll tell you. Really? Yes. My gosh, look at that horse. There's never seen a horse like that. You ever seen a horse like that, Joe? No, never seen a horse like that. Wow. You know, it's kind of like that. It's like, I can't figure it out. Where would that horse come from? How'd you get that horse? I don't understand. This is something I don't quite understand. And so this brings the numinous into the play. You know, there's the appearance of the numinous, the numinon, something like that. Something numinous enters the play, and some people just say, whoa, what is that? What is that? What is this? Tell me, I explained it to you. I don't understand. You know. And what happens? They have the wow. The wow enters. The wow enters the situation. And those who practice the wow, they realize, they just sit down and say, wow, let me just sit down. I just want to sit down. Wow. They recognize, as a wow, the wow factor is here now, has now come upon the scene. As I've said, it will. Why do you think we've been practicing so much, so intensely here? So we know exactly what to do when the big wow enters this scene, this town out west, this western town, where this bar fight is now raging, and will spread and spread and spread, and the hillside is slipping, you know, and down into the mine, you know, enter the numinous, the wow, and what do? You just sit down and realize, whoa, I got to preempt the wow. I know it's going to hit hard. I rehearse it. I say, what if I see Jesus right now? You know what I do? I just immediately sit down somewhere. Just wherever, comfortable place. I know I can remain sitting for quite some time. Just sit down. And just like this, quiet, just sit down. Because I know the wow is going to hit, and it's going to hit hard. So I'm going to put everything, all effort, all will, into remaining stable and full stop in the wow. You know, those are the smart ones. Now, you don't just say, hey, who are you, a stranger? Jesus, you're Jesus? Wow. Jesus, I didn't think I know a lot about you. What do you think about that parable there? Jesus and start talking. No, it's stupid, you know, because you're not realizing the situation. The numinous is here. The big wow is here. You immediately go into practice, full stop in the wow. Don't say a word. You don't have to say a word. You recognize the situation right off the bat. You just go quiet. So it's all set up. It's all set up. So, you know, time for the wow to enter the scene. The movie's now underway. Time for the wow to enter the scene. And we know what to do. Don't challenge, don't debate the wow, don't challenge the wow, don't ask questions the wow. the wow factor's there. Immediate go into full stop in the wow practice. And we have, of course, this is where I am is now. This is where I am is now. This is where I am is now. So I can only hope that this video resonates, you know, in the world, resonates. It sure resonates with me. Yeah, I can see it now. There's no question of what's going on. This is really something. It is life imitating art, to say the least. On a grand stage. A very grand stage. This is the full production now. This is the full production. But the full production isn't full production until the wow shows up. The wow is part of the full production. This is what we realize. I said, Jesus has already returned here. Around May 1st. So when he made the announcement, spiritual announcement, is he in the flesh or just spirit? I don't know. Don't know. What role is Jesus going to play? I don't know. But he's back right at the right time. Yeah. So the wow factor, you've got to believe it's going to be in play for sure. Because I said, this is the full play right now. This is, we're going to get the full play. Okay, this isn't Hollywood anymore, folks. It's the end of Hollywood, actually. What's happening now is the end. Hollywood has ended, just like the papacy has ended. All these things have ended. The presidency has really ended. Politics has ended. Economics has ended. Everything has ended now. And it's all shifted now into this huge play. This huge movie. That's what's actually taking place now. And the Pope is no longer the Pope at all, right? The Pope is now an actor in this play. Absolutely. So again, now we're in the big production. All this other, these subplots, you know, have now all blended been subsumed into the bigger play, where the fullness of the play now, and the wow factor enters, and the mudslide enters, you know, and the bigger picture of what's going on enters. The whole play is now presented. The whole play is now presented. So we're part of the wow factor. See, we have to play our role. We're part of the wow factor. So I got to remind myself that, you know, got to play my role. Got to be part of the wow factor here. Don't get caught up in playing other roles. I could play a role, that role. And well, yeah, but that's not the role that I'm assigned. You know, I gotta play the role that I'm assigned. You know, play along as part of the wow factor. You know, maybe I'm one of the townsmen that, you know, the wow factor comes into town, and I sort of say like, hey, stranger, you know, where'd you come from? I haven't seen you around these parts. You ever been here before? Where'd you come from? You know, or something like that. You know, just play a role in some way. It's like, gosh, we're having a lot of troubles here. You're a stranger in the town. You think you might give a look at it and give us some help in some way? Because sure appreciate your help. You look like a outstanding quality character there, and we sure use your help here. Hey folks, a stranger just rode into town and looks like an outstanding character and never seen anything quite like it. And I sure asked the character if I could get some help from our situation here. You know, and people say, oh, really? Really? You know, I don't know what this be. That's just an example, you know. So this is pretty awesome. What's going on? Well, we got to stay in our roles. Stay in our roles, you know. Those who are in the part of the wow role, you know, we got to play our roles really well, really well. That's for sure. So hopefully I'm over the last final fit, you know, saying I could have played a real great bar fight role. You know, no question about it. Well, you know, yeah, if you're a really good actor, you're an actress, you can probably play almost any role. But the wow role requires special sort of training for you know, it really does. You got to be really, really good to play this role as far as your training goes. In order to stay in character, you know, you really got to be the top of the top or most to stay in the character of the wow role, that is for sure. So this is where I am is now. This is where I am is now. This is where I am is now. Okay. Very great. And we'll see how it goes from here on out. Very good. Let's stop the catcher right. Stop the catcher right now. That's it, folks.